Julia or Fanny?
No, no, I do not.
You don't have confidence.
I don't have a confidence. Anybody that is white that is doing an investigation about a black young man that was shot 7 times in his back and haven't come up with an answer or a comment at this point is not welcome.
If two black people killed a police officer, they would instantly become heroes.
Yeah.
Paddy Chayefsky's network should be required viewing from first grade through college. At some point, everyone just really needs to see that movie and recognize that even back in the early 70s, this was happening. I mean, to some degree, you know, the news is a reality. You have, you know, real grievances with people and it's being exploited, and that doesn't mean that they don't still, you know, come with their whole heart, ready to die or to fight. But the way he captures the absurdity of television news producers making contracts with, you know, people like Patty Hearst and Angela Davis and the Black Panthers all in this little cabin arguing about, you know, what money they should get, and it's so intense and yet really comical at the same time.
For justice in Poughkeepsie, how those close to Maurice Gordon say the community can help them find answers. These stories and more right now.
I pulled you over. You're definitely moving. You know that too. You saw the lights on the right hand side.
Yeah.
I saw you start slowing down.
Yeah.
Where are you headed to in such a hurry?
If two black people killed a police officer, they would instantly become heroes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Where are you headed to in such a hurry? That's at 101 miles per hour.
Yeah.
So, what's the reason for that?
What makes it worse is being left in the dark for so long and not being given any answers.
I'm trying to get to a very far place.
To where?
I'm trying to get to a very far place.
Where's that?
In the video game.
To where?
End of the video game.
The end of the video game?
Yeah.
Today, we still don't have all the answers that we need. And I'm truly tired of another black man being killed.
So imagine a cop asking you, after going 110 miles an hour, where are you going? And you tell him you have to go to a very far place to finish a video game.
Okay.
The end of the video game?
Yeah.
And him being treated as if he were on trial.
So I really don't want to make light of it. But honestly,
on May 23rd, Gordon was shot and killed by New Jersey State Trooper.
The video I saw was at least 17 minutes long. And he was stopped not once, not twice, but 3 times. And then this final time, he ends up attacking the cop. And they have dash cam footage. The court system is obviously far from perfect, but imagine replacing it with trial by media.
Okay. Yeah, I got him. He was in my car.
Okay.
Wasn't giving the mask. He tried getting out of my car. We got in a fight on the side of the road.
Okay.
He tried running into my car. I got him out, sprayed him. We got in a fight again. He ran away from me, tried to hop my troop car, grab my gun.
Okay.
We were fighting with my gun, and I shot him. He's already cuffed.
He's already cuffed?
Yeah, he's cuffed and down.
If two black people killed a police officer, they would instantly become heroes.
Yeah.
I think because of the relationship that black people have had with police officers over the course of time. Like, yeah. I don't think of black people thinking
they would become heroes, you said.
I thought so. That just instantly sort of, that's what I thought.
Killed a cop and then took his gun.
I'm not a criminal.
You are now.
Mm-hmm. You are now. Lena Waithe joins us at the table. I want to get the backstory of how this came about, because you were having a conversation with James Fry, best-selling author.
Okay, so James Fry, the same guy from Oprah's book club.
Gut-wrenching memoir that is raw and it's so real. Our next book is A Million Little Pieces.
So Oprah really makes it number one on the bestsellers list. And then he's accused of lying.
So do you think you lied or you think I made a mistake?
I think probably both.
Most memorable moments of all time in between Michael Jackson and Tom Cruise jumping on the couch is now simply
James Fry, best-selling author.
Best-selling author. You barely catch that she's even mentioning his name. It all plays into the theme here, which is fiction, masquerading as news, and the line keeps getting blurrier.
Black people think
they would become heroes, you said.
I thought so. That just instantly sort of, that's what I thought.
We just talk about whatever the national conversation is right now. We don't, like, I don't set any agenda. It's whatever people are talking about. So, you know, it's odd, it's strange. It's another thing in the on the list of bizarre.
Yeah.
Another, on the bonfire of normality, throw another log on.
And Gail's like, don't forget about the jogger. Remember the jogger?
That Ahmed Arbery case, too.
Honestly, it sounds like she's got a list.
That Ahmed Arbery case, too. I think more and more people are starting to cover that. I think that's a very important story. Mm-hmm. Ordinarily, that, I think, would get more coverage than it's getting. It's bubbling mm-hmm. up. And yes. I think there's more to come on that story, too.
And there'd be more protests if people exactly. felt comfortable being together in groups.
Exactly right.
I want to put my foot on his fucking neck like he threw up. I want to put my foot on his back like he threw up. I want to hang him from a fucking tree like he threw up. At the end of the day.
Story too.
And there'd be more protests if people exactly. felt comfortable being together in groups. And there'd be more protests if people exactly. felt comfortable being together in groups.
Including asking questions of those we cover, and that's exactly what we were doing. Fager, Rose, and former CEO Leslie Moonves have now all been forced out of CBS after allegations of misconduct. Two outside law firms are conducting an ongoing investigation into those reports and into the overall culture here at CBS. Never expected this.
No, of course. I mean, this is a very difficult story for us to cover, and certainly for you.
The myths around black people being lynched, which were that black people were, you know, sexual predators and violent, was actually that black people were often accused of rape after consensual sex with a white woman.
Big trees are falling at CBS, but I really do believe that the company wants to and will get this right. I can only imagine what this has done to you, how this has affected you. And I certainly applaud you, Drika, for speaking up.
I spoke to someone here that I've
been
working...
Did you view it as a threat?
I did.
Yes.
And it's even hard to say that today because, yes, we do receive harsh language all the time, but this is someone who held an enormous amount of power here.
Out someone who is your colleague and your friend who you love and care about.
Well, it's very difficult.
It makes you emotional.
It does, and I don't want to sit here and boo like a girl.
And I was shocked.
I think once people saw that text, they might have felt differently about it. It certainly sounded like a threat.
It was a threat.
Yeah.
But I thank everyone here for their support. So many comments. I can't say that enough about the people within this organization who've sent me text messages, emails, viewers, people on Twitter. So I'm extremely grateful for that.
And we at CBS this morning support you 100%.
Thank
you. As well as the news division. Thank you, Drika.
Thank you.
I don't know what is true. And I don't know what isn't. So first of all, I wanted to start with the smoking gun report titled The Man Who Conned Oprah.
I've struggled with the idea of it and...
the lie of it. That's a lie. It's not an idea, James, it's a lie.
It is also not fiction, but a bold choice. It's taking us right to the edge. It's a gut-wrenching memoir that is raw, and it's so real. Our next book is A Million Little Pieces.
So do you think you lied or you think I made a mistake?
White, black, white, black, white, black, white, black.
Bonfire of normality, throw another log on.
That Ahmed Arbery case too. I think more and more people are starting to cover that. I think that's a very important story. Mm-hmm. Ordinarily, that I think would get more coverage than it's getting. It's bubbling mm-hmm. up. And yes. I think there's more to come on that story, too.
And there'd be more protests if people exactly. felt comfortable being together in groups.
Exactly right.
Yes, I don't know.
The reason why I called Tony, yes. I said she might call Tony. Yes, I called her.
Yeah, no. I mean, that Ahmed Arbery case, too. I think more and more people are starting to cover that. I think that's a very important story. Mm-hmm. Ordinarily, that, I think, would get more coverage than it's getting. It's bubbling mm-hmm. up. And yes. I think there's more to come on that story, too.
And there'd be more protests if people exactly. felt comfortable.
Arbery's family says he was out for a jog unarmed. Now, in newly public video obtained by Jacksonville station WJXT, we see the moments before that encounter. A man walking into a construction site and looking around. An outside angle obtained by the Atlanta Journal-Constitution shows someone entering and leaving a short time later. The videos, both under review by the Georgia Bureau of Investigation, appear to show Arbery. His family's attorneys are not disputing that.
Running into a house being built two houses down from me. When I turned around, he took off running into the house.
Okay. What did he look like?
It's a black male. Red shirt, white shorts.
American man walking in the house. One of the suspects in Ahmad's death, Travis McMichael.
Now, I was living here before you got here.
Oh my God, this is not
you heard me? Did you heard me? Trust Yvonne. My name is Yvonne. I've been living in this bitch before you got here, you disrespectful ass.
How was Ahmad when people pushed up on him the wrong way?
Drug? How the fuck I'm drug attack when I work at Blue Beacon?
Back up.
Check my shit.
Back
right?
up.
The fuck you talking about?
You want back
my
up?
Fucking shit. Bitch, you hit me.
Send me another
shit,
unit, please. Send me
up.
Another unit.
There you had a brown cop and a white victim. I wonder if you switched it, how it would have gone.
Happened. What does justice look like?
The same thing that happened to Muhammad Noor.
Free Muhammad Noor. Free that man right now.
As an artist, I don't know if it's my job to give people answers. It's my job to ask questions and to show us ourselves.
Too much guilt behind breaking that window that I totally agree with, because if I was in that situation, yes, I would probably want to break a window too, or break somebody's face with that brick, especially the person that's keeping me repressed in my neighborhood, that pushes me back into this economic slavery.
So that way we can sort of come to terms with who we are as a society.
As far as I'm concerned, they could burn this bitch to the ground and it still wouldn't be enough. And they are lucky that what black people are looking for is equality and not revenge.
I think of it as protest art. I do believe it's open season on black bodies. And when I look at the news every day,
that Ahmed Arbery case too. I think more and more people are starting to cover that. I think that's a very important story. Mm-hmm. Ordinarily, that I think would get more coverage than it's getting. It's bubbling mm-hmm. up.
185, go ahead with that 27.
Can I have my ID, please?
Yeah, give me a second, ma'am. Why am I fucking with you? Because this area is known for drug activity.
Drug? How the fuck I'm drug attack when I work at Blue Beacon?
Back up.
Check my shit.
Back
right?
up.
The fuck you talking about?
You want back
my
up?
Fucking shit. Bitch, you hit me.
Send me another
shit,
unit, please. Send me
up.
Another unit.
The neighborhood of Soho on Sunday night, but tonight we're seeing it along Madison Avenue in Midtown on my way into work.
Like, why you don't love us? That's the question we want to ask police. Why you don't love us?
And yes. I think there's more to come on that story, too.
And there'd be more protests if people exactly. felt comfortable being together in groups.
Exactly right.
I find it really telling that she leaves out Elijah McCain.
And hear you guys tell stories about black unarmed people that have been killed by police officers. And then a week
disproportionate
later.
Disproportionate numbers.
Absolutely. And then a week later, you report that the police officer is back on the force. Mm-hmm. It's very traumatizing. It's very traumatizing for me. Mm-hmm. Every time
you
I see
that. You said that as a black artist, you take tragedies and make them beautiful.
Mm. Yeah. I don't think we have a choice. I think black people have been making beauty out of misery for decades. And I think that's our superpower.
Killed a cop and then took his gun.
Now Lena Waithe joins us at the table. I want to get the backstory of how this came about, because you were having a conversation with James Fry, best-selling author.
I wonder if Oprah got Jason Blair his job at the New York Times. I have to Google that. Note to self.
I'm not a criminal.
You are now.
You are now. Lena Waithe joins us at the table. I want to get the backstory of how this came about, because you were having a conversation with James Fry, best-selling author.
Yeah.
He planted this little seed for you about this movie.
I mean, he did. He came up to me at a party, and he said, hey, I have an idea for a movie that I can't write. And he's like, it's a black man, black woman, on a first date, on their way home. Police officer pulls him over. Things escalate very quickly, and they kill him in self-defense. Yeah. And I said, and then they decide to just get in the car and go. And I was like, you're right, you can't write that.
You can't, yeah. But I can.
I can.
And you said, don't call it a Bonnie and Clyde story, because your go-to, you would think, is Bonnie and Clyde. You
right.
said, not this time.
No, and I did revisit that film before I started writing, and Thelma and Louise as well. But I think almost the things that I wanted to sort of break those rules and break convention and sort of put people of color in the center of a narrative, and that, you know, we are in a war that we didn't start.
Right.
And I feel like black people, when they walk out their door, they go to war every day.
Yeah.
And they have to decide, what black person do I want to show up as this morning? Do I want to be MLK?
What black person do I want to show up as today? She said MLK. Like, what does that mean exactly? Like, sacrifice yourself for a greater good? And then the idea that Gail puts herself in the movie, gives herself a cameo in this obviously Oprah-produced movie.
So when someone drops something like this in your lap, what do you do?
When something like this just drops in your lap, what do you do? Like, what does that even mean? Like, Oprah hired you? Oprah's producing it, like, and she said my world shook or something.
I immediately, my wheels started spinning, and I just thought, if two black people killed a police officer, they would instantly become heroes.
Yeah.
Did she really just say that?
If two black people killed a police officer, they would instantly become heroes.
Yeah.
I think because of the relationship that black people have had with police officers over the course of time, like, I don't think of black people think
they would become
officers.
Heroes, you said.
I thought so.
Wake up, Gail. Your little protege is going out a little too far on a limb.
They would become heroes, you said.
I thought so.
They would become heroes, you said.
I thought so. I thought so. I thought so. That just instantly sort of, that's what I thought. I was like, if I heard a story about that, I would wonder, like, oh, man, what was that about? Like, why did they do that? And that's the thing. Like, we as, particularly, I think, black people have to create the heroes that we need.
I think what the 1619 Project tried to do, for those of you who are not too young to have seen the movie The Matrix, it's the red pill.
As an artist, I don't know if it's my job to give people answers. It's my job to ask questions and to show us ourselves so that way we can sort of come to terms with who we are as a society.
Your director and someone you've worked with before on the Master of None show, Melina Matsoukas, she has called this a protest film.
Yeah.
Is that something you would use as well?
I mean, I think of it as protest art. I do believe it's open season on black bodies. And when I look at the news every day and hear you guys tell stories about black unarmed people that have been killed by police officers, and then a week later...
Disproportionate numbers.
Absolutely. And then a week later, you report that the police officer is back on the force.
You've said that as a black artist, you take tragedies and make them beautiful.
Yeah. I don't think we have a choice. I think black people have been making beauty out of misery for decades.
For decades. Hundreds of decades.
So to be clear, white people are not writing a check, though if any white person wants to write me a check, I'll give my Venmo after the talk. But reparations is about a societal debt, and it is paid by the government. It's not about punishing white Americans. Anybody want my Venmo?
It's because I'm such a Charlie Rose fan.
Me too.
How do you reconcile?
I don't want to sit here and boo like a girl or like a baby, but...
They had hoped to arrest the suspect so that they could have the day in court, but they had no choice but to open fire because the suspects were armed and considered dangerous. It was a tragic ending to a 6-day nationwide manhunt. Yards away from state lines after killing Officer Reed in Cleveland, Ohio. Bye. Monroe County Police Department released a statement saying,
this is the first time that I'm not constantly talking about the presidential campaign at this
point. So is that hard for you? Is that hard for you?
No, we just do we just talk about whatever the national conversation is right now. We don't, like, I don't set any agenda. It's whatever people are talking about. So, you know, it's odd, it's strange. It's another thing on the list of bizarre.
Yeah.
On the bonfire of normality, throw another log on.
That Ahmed Arbery case too. I think more and more people are starting to cover that. I think that's a very important story. Mm-hmm. Ordinarily, that I think would get more coverage than it's getting. It's bubbling up. And yes. I think there's more to come on that story too.
And there'd be more protests if people felt comfortable being together in groups.
Exactly right.
She has called this a protest film.
Yeah.
Is that something you would use as well?
I mean, I think of it as protest art.
I got to ask you about what's going on your show. Two things.
Yeah.
First of all, there were all these rumors that CBS was after Oprah to be on the show.
Andy, you know that's not true.
Right. I mean, by the way, I would like Oprah to be on this show, but it doesn't mean anybody's...
I don't even know where that started. She doesn't know where it started. There's absolutely no truth to that whatsoever.
That's what I figured. No. I got to ask you this because I'm such a Charlie Rose fan.
Me too.
Love the guy. Interviewed by him.
Me too.
How do you reconcile and
this happens, but we will... I know that we will be okay.
Anybody that is white that is doing an investigation about a black young man that was shot 7 times in his back and haven't come up with an answer or a comment at this point is not welcome.